coverage.
More experience.
More stats.
And that's final.
ET Final Score is brought to you by Ashley Furniture.
Hello, I'm Phil Hicks, and welcome to our ETFinalScore.com high school preview show. Thanks for joining us this week. First off, Harold Wilson and Chris Perry are joining us. But first, guys, what's up with these shirts y'all have on this week?
Well, going back to last week, we had made a friendly wager. My school, Texas State, playing his school, Texas Tech. Most of you probably know what happened. Lightning couldn't strike twice for the Bobcats. So here I am, black and red, Texas Tech, Red Raiders.
I said he would look good in Texas Tech colors, and I felt the need that I had to support my university, and I'm doing it.
So you feel comfortable in that red?
I feel very comfortable in this red, my Texas Tech red.
Very good. Well, now we're going to talk about this week's John Toller and Robert E. Lee game. It is the 55th annual contest, but they played twice 2 years, so this is the 57th annual game, I believe that's right. So first we're going to talk about Lee enters at 0-2 and JT's 1-1. But first, Chris, can Lee pull off the upset this week?
It just seems that whenever Lee has met John Toller, and John Toller's been very favored in the last three or four meetings, they've been able to surprise him. I was talking to Coach Piskey, and I think the Lee coaching staff was the most unhappy that John Toller got beat by Lancaster, because now they're going to be more focused than ever to not have a slip up, and they're really going to take this game more seriously than they might, you know, if they would have gone in there 2-0 feeling good about themselves. Maybe Lee could catch them by surprise. I still think it's going to be a very tight, very competitive ball game like it always is. Now, do I think they can pull the upset? I'm going on a limb. I'm picking them. I think Lee can do it.
Now, Harold covers John Toller Lions. They're ranked number 7 in the state, and they did have a loss last week to Lancaster. Are the Lions focused and ready to take on Lee this week?
Well, based on what I saw, you saw a little more seriousness, a little more attention to detail at practice this week. It definitely got their attention, you know, going in, losing to an unranked team, a team in Lancaster not a lot of people thought John Toller, especially being number 1, would lose to. Now you got Robert E. Lee. They've got a chance to tie this all-time series. So you got history on the line. You got a team that, you know, thought they were number 1 in the state. You got a lot of things that has John Toller's attention. So I think you'll see, if nothing else, their best effort.
Very good. Now, Chris, how can Lee pull off this upset?
I think they've kind of found they've kind of found the mix the last couple of years. And Harold said a comment last night, and I think it's very poignant. And the last 3 or 4 years, he's had to interview a Robert E. Lee running back, after every game, because they've been able to run the football effectively against John Toller. They've got a passing game with Riley Poster. I think they're going to throw in a mix with Jordan, with Jordan Richardson, which will give him kind of a wildcat type look. But I think the key, and it absolutely is the key, is they've got to have success early. I think if John Toller gets a 7-14, 17-0 lead, something like that, it's going to be a long night. But I think if Lee can stay with them through the first half, even take the lead like they've done in two of these last three meetings, then it's a fourth quarter game and anything can happen.
That's true. Harold, last year JT was favored and Lee won. That's mm-hmm. their only win of the year, if I recall mm-hmm. right. Mm-hmm. But then John Toller went on a long winning streak after that.
Yeah, that was great.
What do you think about the Lions coming into this game? I know, was that just a slip-up against Lancaster, or is there more trouble to come?
You know, that's been the question I've been asking myself. People have been asking me this week. You go back to last week, I mean, a lot went bad, but at the end of the game, this team was on the 1 yard line. I mean, they had a chance to win this game. They didn't have a starting running back, Reggie Gibson, who had a big game against Lufkin, had an 81-yard touchdown reception. They didn't have their best leading tackler, Richard Gibson, middle linebacker. They played without a defensive tackle. All those guys are supposed to play this week. You got Robert E. Lee, a team that they should have John Toller's attention, like I said. So, and based on last year, seeing that John Toller did start 0-3 and they were able to rally off 11 straight wins, I think regardless of what happens, I think in the long run, they'll be a good team. Maybe you'll see a few growing pains with the new coaching staff, but I think in the long run, big picture, I think they'll be the team a lot of people thought they could be.
All right, Chris, how is the Lee's a new coaching staff too, mainly, almost all are new. How are they viewing this game?
I think they're viewing it with the respect it deserves. but at the same time realizing that it is a non-district ball game. I mean, the kids are definitely Lee John Tyler, that, you know, it's the ultimate, and I think the coaches are giving it the proper respect, but they want to get better and keep getting better so they are at their top peak when district starts, because let's be honest, those are the games. They may not count in Tyler. I mean, I know this game's big in Tyler, but over the grand scheme of things, the district games are what count the most.
Right, and Harold, as you told me, I believe John Tyler's ahead of the series 28-27-1. Yep. What has to happen for JT to stop Lee from tying the all-time series for the first time?
Chris touched on it. I think the JT guys know it too. They got to stop the run. LaQuintus Wallace has been a thorn in their side, to say the least. They got to stop Lee early, score on him early. You know, I always like to look at common denominators. They both already played Lufkin. John Tyler beat Lufkin by 2 touchdowns. Lee lost to him by 10. Just looking at that, I know it's bigger than that, but looking at that, you got to think John Tyler, if they play the way they're capable of playing, can win the game. But they can't let LaQuintus Wallace run the opening kickoff back 95 yards. They can't, you know, start letting Lee feel like, hey, it's 2011 again, it's 2009 again when we beat an undefeated JT team. They're going to have to jump on him early, because you think this John Tyler team can score a lot of points, and maybe Lee can't keep up to him. If John Tyler gets an early start, they'll be in good shape, it looks like.
Well, it looks like it's going to be a great matchup again. It's 7:30 Friday at Trinity Mother Frances Rose Stadium on Earl Campbell Field. And this week, some of our ETFinalScore.com staff will be at the game. They're going to be tossing out T-shirts like the guys are showing you right here. And it's like one of the hottest fashion statements in Tyler and in East Texas. So be sure and get you a T-shirt. And we'll also be throwing some footballs out. So see if you can catch some of them in the crowd. And thanks for joining us. And we'll be right back with Shane Stark previewing the East Texas area.
Hello, and welcome back to the ETFinalScore.com High School Preview Football Show. Before we talk to Shane about the area matchups this week, we're going to tell you about this poster here. This is from the White House and Hallsville game, in which Colbin Patterson and Jake Parker are celebrating a big play by the Wildcats. It's our ETFinalScore.com freeze frame photo of the week. And you can go to our Facebook page on ETFinalScore.com and vote on the best photos of the week. And you might see this hanging at your high school, or it might even be a picture of you. I know I'd love to have maybe a poster when I was back in high school. How about that, Shane?
Oh, yeah, I'd love one too, man. I think the individuals in the shot get a poster for themselves too, right?
Exactly.
So that's pretty exciting, hanging on your bedroom wall at the house. Or I know they took it out to White House this week and presented it to Coach McFarland, and they were pretty excited about it, and I was told they're going to hang it in the field house. So it's a cool thing.
Yeah, it's a real nice decoration. But be sure to look on Facebook and vote for your favorite photo or your favorite player. So now we're going to talk to Shane about the area matchups this week. And there's always some great games in East Texas. First off, I love this rivalry every year. It's Lindale and Van. It's red and blue. And I just love it when they were used to be in a district. They're in different districts now. But tell us, what are your thoughts on this big Vandal and Eagle game this week?
Yeah, I'm the same as you. It's one of my favorite games to look forward to every year. Even though, you know, they're, like last year they were playing for a district title. So obviously that upped the ante a little bit, but you know, in last year's game, Dalton Santos, you know, the big star from Van, it got so, you know, intense between the teams that he got tossed early in the game, and that had an impact on the outcome, I think. But you know, these two teams are coming off losses. Both are expecting to have good years, but you know, open the season with wins, lost in the second week. So I'm interested to see which team, you know, comes out to play. I know last year's game, I don't have the score on top of my head, but it was like 50-43 or something crazy like that. So I expect another fun game.
So fans should enjoy this. It's going to be at Eagle Stadium, 7:30 Friday, and I believe you're covering that game. Is that correct?
Yes, I'll be there.
Cool.
Yes, I may throw out a football or something. Who knows?
Oh, yeah, we'll have some footballs out there for y'all. And then also Chapel Hill, defending state champs. Now, they're 0-2, and they're facing Carthage, who is, I believe, ranked number 7 in the state. Well, what do the Bulldogs, Chapel Hill Bulldogs, right, need to do to turn this around?
Well, I know talking to Coach Sitton after the White House loss last week, he's kind of, his shoulders were slumped. You know, he was kind of, seemed like, wondering what they need to do. You know, he said all he can do is tell his team that they got to, work harder than any other team in the state. And if they do that, then, they'll turn the ship around. You know, it doesn't get any easier for them. You know, they had this tough non-district schedule that everybody knew would have been tough going in, and, through two games, they're 0-2. and they may be playing arguably the toughest team that they've, you know, faced to date in Carthage. We'll just have to see. They just have to play hard, you know, cut down the mistakes, and try to limit, you know, Carthage's offense too.
I know Coach Sitton does a great job out there, so I'm sure he'll get them turned around. And then, now this is always one of my favorite games too, is Battle of the Wildcats to be in White House between Sulphur Springs, who has been in some crazy games. At first, they beat Lee the first week 35-34, and then lost to Sherman 49-44. And of course, White House is 2-0, and they got some high-powered offenses. What about this? Is this a big test for Randy McFarland's Wildcats?
Yeah, I think so. It's a team that they've built a little non-district rivalry with this school over the last several years, and it goes back to when Tyreek Rollison was at Sulphur Springs back in their state championship days. Expect a lot of offense out there. Both of these teams like to air it out. Sulphur Springs, at least in this area, invented the NASCAR offense where they're just moving that ball up and down the field. White House has a tendency to do that as well sometimes, although they like to slow it down every once in a while. I know it's one of those games when you're taking stats you don't really like to be at, because you're just constantly riding and riding and riding, not really getting to watch the game. So I expect same thing, a lot of offense and a lot of points.
Should be a lot of fun. I know watching Patrick Mahomes and Ryan Cheatham and Dylan Cantrell, that's their own little triplets, I guess.
Yeah.
A little different version. But Shane, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
And we're going to be right back with Travis Yosting, look at the TAPS area schools and our show. Okay, and welcome back to our ETFinalScore.com high school preview show. Joining us now is Travis Yosting, who covers the TAPS and private schools in the area. And welcome, Travis.
Thank you.
What is your take from last week's roundup of TAPS games?
Well, I think it has to be Grace's win over Mineola. They looked really impressive. Blake White was really impressive throwing the ball, running the ball as well. And obviously, Cade Clayton is becoming a star. He returned a touchdown 90 yards for a kickoff 90 yards for a touchdown. And they looked really good in beating a pretty good Mineola team.
Now, what games are you looking forward to this weekend?
Brook Hill, or Garrison at Brook Hill, is going to be a big one. Garrison's always got a good team. Brook Hill, you know, they had a week off after an impressive win over Frankston. You know, they're going to be looking to get right back in the swing of things, and they're going to have a tough task with Garrison.
Very good. And then can All Saints get their first win this Friday?
I think so. They've got a team that they've seen before back when Gorman played Beckville in the Tyler Football Classic. You know, they know what they're up against, and their offense keeps getting better after each week, and I think they can do it this week.
Very good. Now we're going to switch gears and talk a little college football. Travis is an A&M grad, and you might have saw his column in a Sunday's paper about the SEC debut for the Aggies. What were your thoughts on this?
I thought it was not too much different from the Big 12. I mean, I don't think obviously it's a little too early to say after one game, but the Aggies, they look just the same. You know, an average team in the SEC is no different than average team in the Big 12, except that you don't have any, you know, local rivalries. But at least they'll have a local rivalry this weekend when they play SMU. That'll be a fun game, and look for them to maybe finally get a win under Coach Sumlin.
How about one more question? How about Johnny Manziel? He's got taller ties. He looked fantastic in the first half last week, and I'm not sure what happened in the second half. Maybe much chance to do since, but what are your thoughts on Manziel?
Yeah, the first half, he was amazing. You know, for a freshman in his first game ever, you know, the coaches are saying, you know, he's a natural, he's born to do this, you know, but then the second half, I don't know, I think the defense kind of keyed on the run a little more, and the Aggies didn't try to throw the ball deep, and that kind of hurt their offense. They didn't get any points in the second half, and that really cost them the game.
All right, thanks for joining us, Travis. Be sure and check in each Thursday and Friday on ETFinalScore.com for our high school preview and some college preview show. Thanks for joining us.